Oh, what happened to the Rubbermaid markers? Who took the Rubbermaid markers?
Somebody stole the markers?
Jeremy stole.
Yeah, Jeremy stole it. Okay, let's talk about the counselors. Really?
Man, he was giving me grief, sorry. Sorry, no, that was easy.
So how do you do and finish a capstone? Two is, one is the format. One is the essence of the material that you put in. The format of a capstone. Okay.
Good job, Jim.
Yeah, he did.
Right. So you kept giving me a hard time about how they're all dried out.
So let's first of all talk about the format. The format of a capstone is typically the following. You have different chapters.
Did it?
Oh, I've brought so many, I just throw the ones away.
That's right, orange back in QA.
Orange, you can't see. I
brought some that are scented.
Or does he get some of that?
Can we write a capstone on this?
That's what I'm thinking about. There's your sample.
I'm with you.
You want to break it into five sections. The first section is typically on a capstone is about the relevance of the problem. What is the relevance of the problem? Why are you looking at that problem? So you have an area called background. You have an area called problem statement. You may have an area called hypothesis, a particular thing that you want to prove, all right? You want to have your general approach to the problem, and that's in essence it. So what is the focus of chapter one? And okay, you say, well, there's a lot of stuff to be written, but I think what this does for us is a fair amount of stuff. Background. The question of the background is, why are you looking at this problem in the first place? What is it that is causing a problem in that area? Why are you looking at the problem, and why would the institution care about why you're doing it? Once you do that, this becomes your relevance. The problem statement is an explicit problem statement, not like, I am going to fix something. It is an explicit problem statement of what it is that you're trying to do. Is it possible that we are looking and enhancing the throughput of a system? I don't know, but that's for you to figure out. All right. Hypothesis that if you did improve the throughput, what would happen? I would produce more, I would do the, what would happen if you could do that? And the approach that you would take. And we're going to talk separately about this approach, fair enough? So we'll talk about this approach. And I'll tell you that what I would have done if I was doing a capstone and if I were you. Chapter two, in this case, could be a literature search. All right, of this approach that you're talking about, how many other people have done it? Who has done it? How has it been done? And you can break it down in your case based on two different things. One, you can look it up in the and say, hey, this approach has been done based on literature search, you know, Johnny in 1999 did something, okay? Or you can also tell us what your organization has done and how they have approached it. Okay. How have they approached these kind of problems? And because if you were at a UT student, you are a UT student, but if you resided there, that I would make you do this. I think this idea of what my organization has done and how they have solved the problem is critical to your understanding how your approach is going to be continued, is considerably different than the approach that's traditionally taken in your facilities. Chapter three is your approach. You are going to put your approach together in the form with no numbers in it. You're going to just explain to me your approach, your methodology, your mathematical formulation, whatever it is, that is what you're trying to do, okay? Then you come back and apply. This is your case study. You take this approach that you have developed, that is your approach that you've learned in this class, and you apply it to your systems. And then in chapter five, you say how brilliant you are.
Longest chapter of all.
And how you do that is you look and say, these are my contributions. My organization has never done this before. The effectiveness of my approach was this. This is what I have been able to get done. Now, this is your format. So the question then becomes, is for those that are worried about us seeing anything, because if it says it's going to take 8 months for me to get you my material, you can at least send me everything up to here and everything up to here, and the only thing that I can take out is this, and then you can send that to me later, right? I'm not supposed to see what your process is, okay? But this has no process, this has no process, this has no process, this has nothing in it, you know? So I'm able to see 4/5 of what you have done. Right. And where I am primarily focused on is this. What problem did you solve, and how did you solve it, and how was it different than how it's been solved? This is, in essence, the format of your capstone. So now the question then becomes is, when I get here and I start looking at my approach, all right, what should I do? I am now going to break this for you separately. This is your chapters. It kind of gets you an idea of what you have to do. What is the proof of a capstone? The proof of a capstone is I have mastered the material taught in the classes. Every class, not every class. You choose segments of your classes and you say, watch, I have come up with a different way of thinking, and I am not using 100% of all the things that have been taught to me, but I'm using 30%, 60%. It doesn't make a difference that I, based on my education, have come up and used a bunch of techniques that allow me to do what? Make an approach and make a difference. That is the acid test of a capstone. If you give me a capstone that has no new material and how you have thought through the process, then becomes an issue. Then the question is, if you could have solved it 2 years earlier without going to class, why would we give you a degree based on exactly having it done the same way? So you have to show me in this approach right here, this is your key on what you're going to do. Right? Now, you've taken a lot of courses, so you can say, my God, I am going to do statistical analysis. Fair enough. I am going to do some optimization. Fair enough. You could show me those, but what before you use statistical analysis and before you use optimization and other things, there are two sets of classes that you've taken. One that provides an understanding of an approach, and one that fundamentally supports that understanding and approach with different types of tools. Those are the two classes they've taken. For example, if you say OR, OR in itself is not a fundamental way of doing it. If you understand what you're trying to do, I can formulate a mathematical program. Not very hard. Okay? And again, Carla and I were talking because they're teaching optimization. You only learn optimization because it makes English sense to you, not because I'm memorizing. For example, if you tell me, and we were working with, they're teaching optimization there. So we went there last week or week before last, and I said, if I was to fix my family and my family's life, here's the way I would formulate it. What X1, X2, so those are tools to do it. Statistics is what? If you know what data you want to analyze, it's a set of tools. Systems thinking is what? An approach, okay? Reliability is what? Both slightly an approach, but slightly a set of tools. Right? Lean is what? A way of thinking, but a few tools. You see, each of these classes is different. Now the question is, of all of these set of classes, how would you think? Now, let me tell you what I learned based on the classes that I've learned. Are we okay with this? Okay. Any concerns? Yes. Okay. So what I would do is I would identify, first of all, the problem. And the problem in this thing is everything is a system. Everything is a system, right? Is anybody looking at something that is not a system? You are? What are you looking at?
I'm focusing on one particular assembly line, just one machine.
It's still a system.
Yeah. No, I'm saying that it is, because it gets inputs and outputs from outside of itself.
Because a system is what? If that set of machine, that machine inherently has materials coming to it, it has components in the machine, it has a lot of stuff, it is a smaller scope. But it's a system. You raise your hands too.
Mine is an operational model.
Operational?
Operational
what? I didn't get the second word.
Oh, sorry.
Operations model for a nuclear facility. Is that a system? Yes or no?
Yes.
A system is what? What is your definition of a system? A system is something that has a goal or a function. It has entities, and you have interconnectivity among these entities. If those are the basic requirements that it's met, then it has, it is in essence a system. Is that okay? Right. Tell me your approach. I'm trying to help you with my capstone. I'm trying to kind of learn the material, but I'm trying to cheat. Okay. I'm trying to learn the material because I always wanted to learn the material, but I also wanted to go to spring break, so I want to make sure that I could learn it in the most efficient way. What? How would you approach this problem? The question is your approach, isn't it? the approach. And what I would do is what I would say, oh my God, I have a system, and this concentration that they have put me through is called a systems concentration. So my focus should be, if I really want to impress everybody around me, is going to be a focus on system.
So does your approach, for my particular process, there's no one really seems to know a specific problem or issue, aside from the overarching goal of trying to put more out. Would your approach lay out where you think that the problem could lie as well? Or is it more just what you pick one problem and put it out front and then tell your approach how to fix that problem?
I would, to work with you, okay, because you've spent 2 years, the first thing I would ever do tell you is, if you do not see a problem, don't solve it.
Well, I see it, but other people in my organization don't.
And that's the most important thing. If you see it and nobody else sees it, there's a tremendous amount of value to what you bring to that organization.
Right.
So it's whether you see it or not.
Okay.
Don't worry about everybody else.
Well, just if I was going to take this to them, like part of it would be explaining why I see that as a problem.
No, that's not. I would actually appreciate that you are taking something that you have learned, and you are now mentoring, to some extent, if I can call it that, other people on the way you're starting to think.
Okay.
So
yes, sir.
So I would assume that you would start by, if it's a system that's already in place, I would assume that you would start by defining that system.
That is correct.
And mapping that system, and then if it's a new system, maybe even have a future state. Possibly, I don't know if it's new design.
Here's what I would do. If I could, again, for this particular project, I would not pick a brand new system. I would make it, I told you I'm lazy. So it makes it much easier to collect data and understand the process. If the process exists, good or bad, it is just easier. What do you do? What do you do? What do you do? What do you do? If the process doesn't exist at all, and we're working with two processes that we worked on over the last year with more help, the processes don't exist. You know how long it took us just to collect, understand the process, and collect the data? I would say 6 to 9 months. Because you talk to somebody, oh, I don't know what the process looks like, oh, I look like it's this, I don't know. So you have to kind of interpret that, it just makes it a little bit more difficult to do. So, your focus is what? A system. So the first thing in a system, is what? The function or goal. Now, if I was looking at it, I said, oh my God, function or goal. Let me do something that is now there. This is my filter. My filter, remember, is my throughput, my cycle time, my WIP, okay? And if I break all of this down, I can break it into flow, variation, disruption, and then each of these has a set of tools. Watch this. Now, you see, now, if your problem was variation, oh my God, I got a whole bunch of variation someplace, and I'm going to fix it. What classes would you use? Statistics. If it was flow, you would use what? Lean systems, maybe, okay? In order to model the lean systems, you may use operations research. And if I was looking at disruption, I could use a class called reliability. I have, depending upon where I see the problem, it helps me concentrate on the things that I am going to use. So here is my impact. These are my tools and my methodologies right here. This is my filter. This is where your focus of the thing is. This is your impact, okay? And this is all of your tools. Now, what have I done? I have now taken that function, okay, that function, because the function could be, I want to reduce cost. I want to reduce overtime. I don't know. I want to improve the quality. Whatever those are related to what you're learning in this, is runs through a filter. That filter is called throughput. That throughput can be impacted by flow, by variation, and by disruption, and a lot of the classes in here support each of these different components. That is the way I would structure the first part. Function of a system. The second is, what was the easiest thing that I learned about describing a process? The easiest thing I learned. And I would work it, notice, this is my goal. I've taken care of one factor of my systems. Then what I would do is I would come back here, and what is this? And I would highlight the process in the form of a value stream map. What have I now used? If someone says, oh, if I came back and said, oh, I believe this is a terrible capstone. You said, no, let me tell you. I've already, based on this, used two classes. Systems thinking and lean. And I can't argue with that because you have fundamentally used that. Now, doesn't have to do, but this is the way I would do it. I would then come back and I said, okay, if that was the case, watch this. Material, people, schedules, and equipment. Do you see that? If I now did that, what would I be able to do? I can say I've got how many classes now covered? Three classes. And if I could break this down, watch this now. I'm doing this and see if this makes sense. Again, I'm just showing you a approach. You can take this approach, you can modify this approach, but it will give you an approach. And I said, in materials, I'm really worrying about quantity of being correct. I'm worrying about quality being correct. I'm worrying about the timing that I get this material correct, and I want it in the right location. You see that? Now, and I said, oh my God, I want to do something else to this. I want to show some mathematical rigor to it. And I said, but watch this. This is so ambiguous. This is neither series nor parallel nor any of that kind of stuff. So what would I do? You know what I would do? I would start out, what is this? Your vector. Each component of the vector, what does this represent? Quantity. This represents quality. This represents timing. This represents location. I would go and I said, well, that status vector for that is one, isn't it? But I also know that the status vector for all of this is zero. Is that not correct? The question that I told you when Muhammad Ali was here and I was talking, I said, this information comes from where? It's not like, oh, let me get that information. It comes from you understanding the process. So if I went to the people that are expert in the process, they could tell me whether 1010 is a one or a zero. And from that analysis, watch this, from that analysis, I could tell you what is the most important factors and how they relate to each other. Can I not? I could say quantity, watch this, I'm just making some stuff up. Quantity and location, and because I use a path vector, there is my equivalent structure. Oh my God. Now, you want to add a little bit more rigor to it. I'm going to say, hey, guys, how often does quantity fail, that we don't get the right quantity. Oh, it happens every once a week. I turn that into what? Failure rate. I look at this and I say, oh, well, how long, often do we not put in the right location? This is, oh, once every 1 month. Failure rate. I take that information, if I have that information, I take that information, I put it into a statistical tool, all right, and it tells me if it's an exponential or viable. I find what? Watch this, what did I just find? If I have that information, what did I just find? The reliability of this and the reliability of this. And now I know both the reliability from the failure rates, or your estimate of failure rates. I now have the equivalent structure. Have I just been able to take this thing right here, and decompose it and figure the reliability of this? Say yes. Yes. If I could do the same thing here, and same thing here, would I not know the reliability of this?
Yes.
Now, I know, so if I had a value stream map, and I should be writing it on the bottom. Now, what do I have? I have process time, you know, the basic stuff, availability, et cetera. Those things that come from lean. But now, what have I added? I've added a reliability term. I would never be able to argue with you on your capstone, because you have now shown me systems thinking. You have now shown me what? Entities, and what?
Interconnection
of these entities. You have set it up in a system structure. You're now looking at not only reliability, watch this, reliability, but you're looking at it from a lean perspective. Okay. And I'm going to add one more thing on the top if I was doing this. In this group, what motivates people? What is that called? Stock. Getting off on spring break. Ooh, but if that's the case, all of this is misaligned. So I would put in the motivation, or what I would call stock. This approach has never been done to my knowledge. And what does it do for you? What does it do? Now you say, well, let me use some mathematical rigor that I used. Fair enough. If you want statistics, you can go collect the data, do a statistical analysis. If you want to do an OR, I can set this program as an OR program. I can in different ways. I can set this up. X1 could be the amount you produced here, X2 could be the produced here, X3 could be the produced here, X4 could be, and I can set it up in an OR fashion. Depend upon what you want to solve, can use every single thing or a subset of that, but that's not the important thing. If I could do this and I could put in the process time, I can put in what? The reliability. If I could look at the stock, could you not tell me that you have a better insight into that system than anybody else? Why? Because you can say, yeah, your process time is 2 seconds, but look at your reliability. Look at, you've never got your material on time. That's why you have a problem. I can go down and look at what are the areas of disruption. I can look at the flow of that system, or I can look at the motivation of the people and say why they're not engaged. This would be the structure that I would use. And what I would do in addition to this, to support it, is if you need to do data analysis, use statistics. I now have used, just by this simple concept, 4 or 5 classes. Yes?
So after you evaluate that whole system, before you change your system, would you then evaluate your requirements and stakeholders?
There you go. Excellent. You know what he just did? He said, by looking at this process, I can add another level of depth by simply saying, this is my bottleneck, watch this. This is my bottleneck, this is my pre-process, these are my post-process. I can go back up here to the impact. I can go back to some of the key areas of support, not all of them, the key areas of support. I now can tell you, in order to design this properly, these would be the key stakeholders, and these are the key requirements of it. I've now added requirements planning to the class. But this structure allows you what? This structure allows you what? Without having to force different classes in, automatically it does it for you. And why I am pushing this, because if you could do this and prove it, you are uniquely different than anybody that I have known that looks at systems. Because this model does not exist. This is a model we have created. That would be my capstone. Or you could try to look at something and say, ooh, what kind of data should I get? What class should I use? See, that's two different completed approaches. You want your ability to analyze systems drive your thoughts, and therefore it automatically, there is no agreement. I cannot, even that Carla says, fail them. I inherently could not fail you because, my God, where would I fail you on? What would I fail you on? Where I could fail you on your capstones is, I look at what you did and I inherently don't see any difference or any mastery of the material that we have used. And it simply said, I looked at the process, I saw that Bobby was not working with Billy, and therefore I fixed that. Well, what does that have to do with the 2 years of classes that you took? That had nothing to do with it. We're not looking at your ability to solve a problem. We're looking at your ability to solve a problem in a very unique, different way. That is your capstone. And I really appreciate it, because I forgot about, even though I had it in my mind, I forgot about requirements planning, because this concept in a section 2.1 could say, I am using this breakdown as a way of looking at requirements as well. This is going to give me a uniquely different way of looking at and designing that system. Are we okay?
What yes. You know, with the capstone, is it just the paper, or is there any kind of board that we have to sit in front of and explain? And
you're going to have to sit in front of three people and explain, and they're going to ask you questions. And depending on who you have sitting in front of you, it could be like, hey, great job, you know? And it'd be like really encouraging, here's your gift. Or I have seen people at the committee tear people up. Why did you do this? How do you know that's true? I mean, not on the cohorts at this moment. I have remembered a person getting up off a committee, walking up and saying, this is all bullshit, and walks out, and the person doesn't graduate for another 2 or 3 years. So you have that level of burden on. Now, the good part is that generally the people that we have on the committees are people that are looking to encourage you and make sure that they positively, constructively criticize you to make sure that you have it correct, but not stop you from doing this. Yes.
If our project is about 112, do you have committee members that are allowed to see the content like you are? So we can actually go through our process, because if we make it about work, we won't be able to tell.
Mark Cook will probably be one of the committee. He will be, and then one other, the other one has to be.
I don't know, but we could work that out. I mean, for me, if Mark can see number 4, section 4, and I can see 1, 2, 3, and 5, and Mark comes back and says, you don't have to worry about it. It fits that need, I'm okay with that. Because I'm looking at number 3, because 3 will give me an idea of what you have done. So I really don't need 4 to say, oh, we're building widgets and the widget was not okay.
I think section 1, where we talk about the background, may be the content that we really can't tell everybody. because if we're going in depth about official information about our work, then we're not going to be able to share that with everybody.
Mark can look at that.
Okay, so we'll just have to go through classification and figure out how.
Yeah, I mean, we'll have to do that because then Mark can look at it. I think about that, that's part of the problem, so, you know, like if you're going, yeah. We could perhaps Mark can look at it.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. Again, reason I'm pushing this, you spend 4 semesters, 2 years of every Friday, how many Fridays is that? A lot. You have to take something out of this class beyond a degree. And I think that's where we're focused on. Everybody okay? Now, I am giving you how I would have done it. Does not necessarily mean this is the way you do it. You see, that would be my approach. Are we okay? All right, aren't you? So, on you now, are we ready?
Ready for what?
This is where, you know, I was nice. I said, let us be nice. So here's what we're going to do. You have a very open-ended case study for requirements plan. It's been sent to you, and initially they found a case study of how to make donuts in Turkey. We changed that to an ambulance service in London, England. All right, and what's wrong with that? It does not have all the information that you need, but it provides you the structure of the problem. Wherever you think you need some numbers, you make those numbers up. I am interested in how you analyze the requirements and use everything that we taught in the class. Right? For example, how are you going to select your stakeholders? I don't just want you to say, I'm going to call Billy and Bobby and everybody else. I want to have a mathematical understanding of how you're going to do it. If you have a lot of priorities, I want to know how you're going to do what. Prioritize. So everything in the class that we have taught you, all right, fundamentally is what you're going to. And then the last question was, if you are, there are 4 questions actually, but the main were, how do you set up the model? How do you determine the stakeholders? How do you prioritize the requirements? And if you were to conduct and get buy-in from the company on how to do it, how would you conduct that meeting? Those are, in essence, so nothing different than what we have covered in class. But what I did was, instead of giving you numbers, I let you come up with the numbers. That way, it allows me to understand what numbers you're looking for. What are you doing? And it gives me an insight. And every time you say, I think I needed numbers, here it is, 1, 2, 3, I would know. I'm not worried about 1, 2, 3. I'm worried the fact that you knew that you were supposed to look up 1, 2, 3. So I'm going to look at it from that perspective. And that is posted already, isn't it?
Yes.
So that exam is posted. Okay. The second exam, take the exam. It is the same exam that I gave to the to people at UT. I have gone from very simple, the simplest problem, and I've tried to build this model. Okay? So the first one is, if the reliability of this was this and reliability of this was this, what's the reliability of the system? You should be able to figure that out. So I'm trying to build your confidence. The only thing that you can find is, you're not going to like my exam. Because you have an hour and 15 minutes, and we're going to give them another 5 or 10 minutes because Srivathi gave them 5, 10 minutes extra. You're going to run out of time. I do not want you to ponder. Go with your gut feeling, first gut feeling, and solve the problem. Are we okay? If you're going to say, what should I do? Do it this way or do it this way, you're going to find out that you've solved 3 problems out of 7 problems. Are we okay? if you complain at the end about the exam was really unfair, I want you to focus your anger where?
So is the intent that we're not going to finish?
The intent is to push you to the limit. And my limit is that limit tells me and distinguishes the level of mastery of that material. If I gave you three problems and everybody was expected to finish it, I cannot distinguish who knows what. Because I've increased it by intensity of knowledge, each level of problem, and then I have pushed it to see who does it and who is looking up notes. If you go to your notes and you say, let me look up the notes, okay, you are not going to finish. So it is the intent. The intent is to push you to the limits to see who gets through and who doesn't. But remember this. If you're worried about the grade, I control your grade. I can make 20 an A if I want it.
Yes.
I would. if I like a class, if you prove to me, and here's what I can do. My intention is this. I would love for you guys to take some of this stuff back to work and make a change. If you do that, I could give 20 an A because you accomplished what I want. Are we okay? So I would not worry too much about the grades. Let me come back to you and say, you worry about the grade. You worry about the grade. You worry about it. Until I tell you that, you don't worry about the grade. Right? You do the best job that you can do to use the exam as a learning tool. Give them exam. And then you're done. Go and enjoy your spring break. Okay, she is going to set up the following Monday.
Hey, is that brain powder?
I wish.
Okay. I'm going to Colombia, Medellin, the house of Pablo Escobar. So I'm going to be back Monday. Then I'm going to go to Mexico. I'm going to be back Monday. And I'll go to Mexico again. So Monday, whatever Monday she decides, I'm going to meet with each of you at Y12 or ORNL. And then talk to you about your specific approach to your counseling.
I can thank Dr. Garcia with you. I've been giving an amazing tour, guys.
Steak and coffee.
I'm not going to say that. Colombian coffee and the steaks. And he's always thinking about the steaks.
The steaks are from Texas.
Argentina has been. I was on
the air. Some people had their lean project that they haven't done their taking care of their completed. Some have already turned them through and they haven't been posted yet because what we're doing is going and posting them all at once so they don't have an individual. So what we're going to do is I'm going to get a hold of Matt Smith and have him.
Do I not have an office? I thought they were going to give me an office.
I don't know where it is.
I know I have an office. It's on the second floor of the Jack case.
And then I'll send you guys.
But I don't have no
I'll
idea
send
where.
You guys the dates, and then you guys set up the times, and probably allow that.
I want you to not tell me what you're going to work on. I want you to bring me how you're going to model this. That's what I can help you. Because I don't know what your problem is. But if you tell me what your model looks like, I can help you.
Got it.
Right? So, if you hate the exam, who are you going to blame?
Carla.
All right, give her the exam. Did we give him the exam? Do you want to take a 5-minute break before I give you the exam?
Yes.
Or what?
Yes. I think some people might have problems. Yeah, just give us 10 minutes extra. Who has to pass their notes? Who wants to take the exam? Oh, yeah. Okay.
What?
The threes have it.
It worries me when you're close to deadline. It worries me when you insist.
So we can use our notes.
What happened to
Yeah.
Does anybody know?
He's got to call work.
It's not fair that we think this exam.
Yeah. He's not here. And neither is Jay.
So.
See, I would want Jay to take it because he has not been in class.
I know. I want
so
Jay
he would
to
make
it.
Like 6 out of 100.
Yeah, plus he's moved us.
There's
moved up right now. So.
With Derek,
no,
he gets zero.
I wouldn't underestimate.
Seriously?
Yeah. It's pretty strong.
Yeah, because he doesn't
have to. I wouldn't underestimate Jay.
No,
I can't. Well, that's made a 24-hour take.
Look at that.
What the heck is that? Okay. Pass it out.
This way.
Okay, yeah. What are you doing?
Ruby,
you weren't kidding. That's a lot of paper. That's a tree.
It is. It is 7 problems. And they have come back. Shimanti helped me put it together. She made it. I went back. I said, no. She brought it. Eventually, as we were walking down to give the exam, she said, can we take a few problems off?
Thank you for trying.
Are we good? Go ahead and start. Can you get it? Go ahead and start. What's that?
We got
example. All right. If you have questions and you say, I think I need some information, I don't want you to leave it. All the information is there. But if you think you need something, I'd rather you say, here's the numbers I assume, and I'm working the numbers based on this. Whatever you need, assume it and work it. Good luck and enjoy your break. And there is no such thing as call a friend in.